Okay, small group, good. How many people have used Arduinos before? Hardware, okay, so I guess pretty small group. So the general idea of Fermata, so Arduino is a small hardware control board, usually about 16 megahertz, runs an Atmel chip, right? Small amount of memory, and you write C code, right? The idea of Fermata is that it's essentially a C server that is going to run on your microcontroller and give you a serial connection or some sort of stream connection to your host machine, whether that's a NURBS device, Raspberry Pi, your laptop, whatever it is. And so you can kind of do an asynchronous command and control structure with your microcontroller. So high level. Fermata itself is based on the MIDI protocol. Very simple binary protocol, basically a stream of bytes, which makes it perfect for Erlang and Elixir to parse. We'll see some really, if you get nothing else out of this, maybe if you're not interested in Arduino or anything like that, I think there's some really elegant code that hopefully inspires you to write some good code. So based on the MIDI protocol. MIDI is a protocol for, originally for musical devices, right? So again, having a host machine, a computer or something like that, and giving feedback, you know, like a keyboard, right? Knowing which key you're pressing, or a drum machine, knowing which pad you're pressing on, sending that to your computer, and it can play audio or synchronize different machines along with that. So it kind of makes sense. It maps pretty well to the idea of a microcontroller, right? Your keys or different things being your digital and analog pins. And then it's also got an idea of, so as an example, Fermata to MIDI here, right? So the hex symbol D0 through DF plus one byte. In MIDI, that is, right, your channel plus on or off, right? So is your key pressed on your keyboard? You know, up or down. In Fermata, that actually maps pretty well to our digital ports, right? Is it high and low? So for Fermata, in this sense, we actually use the direct MIDI mapping to map channel pressure to our digital pins. Now, that doesn't always work, right? There's a lot of, so this is from our host, right, messages that we can send to the microcontroller, right, to our little server running there. It's running at about every, it's configurable, but by default, I think it's every 19 milliseconds it does a loop. So that's how often it's polling all its digital pins, all its analog pins, all that stuff. And also looking at incoming messages for configuring stuff or doing different things. So these are all the messages that we can send, well, not all of them, but most of them, all the messages that we can send from our host machine to that microcontroller. Are most people familiar with like looking at binary protocol layouts and stuff like that, right? So this is pretty simple. We've got our start byte. So I2C, right? I squared C is a protocol for interconnect communications. So I squared C, I2C, IIC. So a lot of different sensors, actuators actually support this protocol. You can daisy chain them up to about 254 different devices in a row. So very nice if you have a limited amount of pins, you can actually set up quite a few devices. So Fermata supports this out of the box. Obviously this doesn't map very well to MIDI. So we actually use something called SysX messages, which are built into the MIDI protocol, the system extension messages. We have servo configuration, again using our SysX command here. I squared C configuration, extended analogs. Again, we can set that sampling interval. So by default, it's 19 milliseconds. We can adjust it to whatever we want. Query the capabilities of the board. So each board is slightly different, right? We want to know how many digital pins we have, how many analog pins we have, how many are capable of pulse width modulation, different things like that. Analog mapping query, which pins are analog. Query the firmware name and version. That's actually built into the MIDI protocol. Yes?
Quick question. What's the physical interface?
I will show you. Generally, a USB, just some sort of serial connection, right? So whatever your board is going to support. So right now, it's for, by default, in the Elixir client, it is a UART interface, right? Fermata on the microcontroller side, the current versions can basically take anything that has a stream interface within the Arduino world. So that could be a network interface, that could be Wi-Fi, anything that essentially produces an enumerable in the wiring or C++ code. Currently, On the Elixir side, we're defaulting to UART, but it could be really interesting. I'm actually playing around with implementing it over a 915 megahertz radio spectrum, right? So a custom Arduino board with a 915 megahertz radio, a little gateway on the Raspberry Pi, and then you can have multiple devices kind of all over the place and use a wireless communication. And it's pretty simple. I mean, the stream interface on the C++ side is very, very simple, so not too bad. So again, a bunch of different message types, right? And we'll go through some of the Elixir code, and we'll see, you know, exactly how easy it is to map this to our code. And then incoming, so messages that are going to come from our microcontroller, right? Little C server running there, and messages that it's going to send back to us. So again, sysx messages, the firmware. You know, if we've asked for what you know our capabilities or what type of firmware it is. It'll give us that, our pin state, capability messages coming back, I2C responses, and some of the protocol stuff. So again, so the way these are set up, right, the stuff on the right here is everything that maps directly to our MIDI protocol, and then the system extension messages that we've added for Fermata. Well, Fermata has added, not we. So yeah, kind of gone over this, right? So we're going to have start sysx, right, is F0. Then we're going to have a sysx command type, right, which is essentially our sub-command of what type of sysx message it is. And then up to 1024, 7-bit characters, and then the end of a message, right? So just a big stream of binary characters. So before we get into the code, full disclosure, I was not the original author of the Fermata Elixir library. I am now the maintainer. I do a lot of it with Nerve stuff. So he hadn't touched it since Elixir 1.1, so I kind of took it over for him. But he's responsible for the majority of the architecture and parsing. I have added I2C support, string data. There's an idea. So before it was just one process managed everything incoming from the Fermata board. I added support, right? So sometimes you've got a lot of things happening, a lot of sensor data coming in. So now we've defaulted to whoever asks for the analog pin reporting, right? Whatever process calls into the board and says, "Hey, I want data on this pin," which you'll send every 19 milliseconds. We'll now get those messages back rather than having to do it. So an analog pin to process mapping architecture to help you kind of scale that a little bit more. I've added ultrasonic sensor support and NeoPixel support just for, a project I'm working on. And they're pretty general purpose, so, excuse me, a little dry. And I'll go in, hopefully if we have time, how to add custom stuff to the Fermata protocol. It's pretty easy. So this is our general layout here. I did this Fritzing diagram last night. It's very sloppy, excuse me, but gives the basic idea. So here's kind of your system over here. The stream here really maps to this USB cable, right? And where I was talking like, hey, we could throw in a radio, or you could get a Wi-Fi or Ethernet shield for your Arduino. You can go that way as well. So this is the Arduino side, right? I2C, analog digital servo, or custom stuff. These both happen to be custom. The ultrasonic up there on the right-hand corner is actually it uses a digital pin and actually just measures how long it's high or low, right? So we send out a trigger. This is actually using ultrasonic sound to measure distance, right? So it sends out a ping and measures how long it takes to get back, and that's really just a digital pin going high and low. Interesting thing about that is generally that would be a blocking operation on the Arduino, right? You're going to wait for it to come back. Because we're running this server and we're checking all these different pins, we don't want to block on Arduino. So there's a library that included called NewPing, which essentially keeps an array of all of our ultrasonic devices or all of our pinging devices. And each loop, that 19 milliseconds, will kind of keep track of which ones it sent pings out for and if it's gotten a result back for that, and then update it. So it does it in a non-blocking way. Pretty simple, but works pretty efficiently. And then NeoPixel, again, has a low-level library that Adafruit has provided, also non-blocking. But each one of those pixels is addressable. They make long strips. They make big rings. You can do all sorts of really cool stuff with them. And those are the two I have hooked up here. So we've got our Nerves UART, right, which, again, is going to be that main interface to our serial connection. Fermata.board, which is in the Fermata client. And then generally what you're going to do is for your application, so Fermata example is our application, you're going to kind of, you know, you're going to use the Fermata.board in your init function, I'll show you that, to initialize the board and kind of handle all your logic there. And then we're going to map, right, our I2C analog digital server customs to our own processes within Elixir or Erlang. So let's go into the Fermata.board, right? So this is our core library here. This needs to be much bigger. How's that? Is that legible? Kinda. I always get this question. I'm using Fira code, which has support for ligatures. So you can do arrows, like all the, you get some really nice stuff. You'll see it when we get into it. But Fira code for anybody that is asking. So our first thing here, right, we're going to see this Fermata. We're going to use a behavior here, or macro, Fermata.protocol.mixin. So really all this is giving us our, you know, our different message types, right? We saw that mapping on the first slides there. So report version, right, if we went back to that, that's 0 or, you know, our hex F9. System reset is FF. Digital message. 9-0, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We're actually using a range here for the hex values, which is pretty cool. It's a really nice little feature there, and we'll use that. Again, for the analog messages, same thing. So you can see how we're exactly mapping this. Now, when we added custom features, we basically just need to find a byte or a hex value that isn't taken, right, within our code. I mean, we're going to control that controller, right, that little server on the microcontroller. So we just need to know which ones aren't taken yet. So here, I2C is built in, so that's there, but I added this to the Fermata library. As is string data, let me go down a little further. So here we have the custom stuff, our sonar and our NeoPixel. I basically just found some bytes that weren't taken, some hex values, and used those for configuring our sonars, what our data is going to return, and the NeoPixel stuff there. So let's go to our initialization function of this Fermata.board. Very simple. We're going to open our UART. Again, so that's kind of baked in right now to use nerves.uart. What I'd like to do is, you know, pass in whatever protocol we're going to have and just make it a behavior that you have to implement certain functions, and it'll work. So yeah, we open it. So here we're gonna reset the board initially. So every time we start this up, we want to just make sure we're in a fresh state on the microcontroller. So we're gonna send a reset to our microcontroller, and then we're gonna, just to make sure that worked, we're gonna say, give us our system status, right? And that's gonna give us our firmware version and different things like that. So that's our F9 command. So we just send those right away, and that gives us make sure we're in a nice state to start running. That was the initialization. So yeah. So this is where I think some of the really nice fun code is, right? So we've got our UART open. And the only thing, this is the function that handles all data coming into our system, right? There's only one function that handles any UART data coming in here, and this is it, right? Super simple. Now, obviously, this is calling out somewhere, right? We're capturing this stuff and passing it to our Fermata.protocol.parse. But you can see this. We're actually just doing a reduce, enum reduce, on that string of binary data that we got in, right? So we just got this big string of data. We're actually not doing any framing. We're relying on, which is, It works very well, but we're relying on just kind of the default timings of the nerves UART library to kind of end that string. Although with our, you know, with our beginning system message bytes, you know, we'll only parse one message at a time, or maybe we get a partial message, but as soon as a new string comes in, we're going to clear that out. So,
Chris,
yes. Over the serial, no. It's very, very just like just pushing bytes over the wire. Yeah. So okay. So we're doing a reduce here, right? We've got our data, which is just a binary here. State.outbox, state.parser, and we're going to capture that and call .parse on each of those, and pass our outbox and our parser to each one of those. Our data and our accumulator to each of those. So let's go check out fermata.protocol.parse. Okay, so we're doing just a bunch of function head matching here, right? So we've got a bunch of parse functions. You can see we're gonna use our mixin here, which gives us our hex bytes here to match on. So we're doing some just binary pattern matching here. So it gets a little tricky, right? So we're reducing on a string of bytes. So basically each iteration of this parse is getting one byte into it, right? So we're going to say, okay, if the first byte is report version, let's take our parser and let's create a name tuple, right? So we're going to say, okay, this is report version, right? It's a direct mapping of our binary value here. So we're going to use the tuple report version. Now, we don't know what the rest of the data is yet, right? So again, we're doing that reduce. So the next byte in the string we're reducing on, we're going to call parse again. But we've got our accumulator, we've already got this name tuple with a report version, right? So now the next function, when we call that, we're going to match on what any byte here, we're just going to assume is major. But as long as we have this report version in our parser name tuple, it's going to match on this one. So now we're going to update our name tuple report version. We've got our major byte, right? So we're two bytes into our binary string. Now it's going to call it again. So right, that reduce is calling protocol.parse again. We've got our accumulator with report version, major. We've got the rest of our data. So now, next thing that's going to get matched, right, is report version major. Now we're going to assume that next byte is our minor value, right? So this is getting our firmware version. So now we've got a full message, right? That's all that's coming along with our report version message. So now we're going to put that into our outbox, right? And anything else. So maybe we got multiple commands in that one string that we've had. So we're going to prepend that to our outbox. And then empty our parser. We're done parsing that message set, so let's clear out our parser accumulator. And now we've got an array. So let's assume that's all we get back, right? So now we're done. We've got an outbox. Parser is empty, but outbox is an array with these different parsed commands that we've gotten back, or maybe just one. We're going to do an enum each. And just send those to ourselves, right? So now we've got a name tuple with the values in them that we're going to send to ourselves, right? So if we look at the next function, right, we're now sending a message to ourselves. We're going to handle info, report version, major, minor. And here we actually, after we get our version, we're just immediately going to go get a capability response, right? And this is, again, really the only time you're going to call this is on that startup procedure, right, is we reset, we get firmware version. So now let's just go get our capability response. This one's kind of unique in that it's going to make a call built in, but this is kind of the startup procedure here. We're going to update our state with our version here. And then send info. And send info sends it to the originating calling process, right? So that Fermata example.board is going to now get a message of this after we've done our kind of what needs to happen in the built-in core library. So does this? So this is right. I think this is some really really elegant code. A great way to handle binary parsing. Does anybody have questions on this? Is it pretty clear? The next one, right, because most of this stuff is handled with sysx messages, would be doing a very similar thing with the sysx messages, right? So we get our start sysx byte. Now, These are general purpose, right? These are or system extension messages. So it's not part of our protocol, right? It's not part of the MIDI protocol. These can be anything. We can extend these. Now there's some defaults built into Fermata, which we know. But we're going to do a very similar thing here, right? We're going to get our start. We're going to match on our start sysx byte. And put that into our parser. So we're going to match on our start sysx byte. This always confuses me because actually the next one that gets called is after the end sysx. But now we're going to keep, right, that reduce is going to keep calling this guy until we hit end sysx, right? So we don't want to, this can't move up above this because, it probably could. Because end sysx would never get matched. This would always match and end sysx wouldn't. So this has to be first. So call this. We're going to keep filling our parser with each byte, each new byte that we get in, and appending it to the sysx until we hit end sysx. And now we do the same, not quite the same thing. Now we've got our sub command. We've got our start sysx. The next byte is always our sub command for sysx, and then we have all our data. So if we look at our start, so this is essentially the exact same thing, only just for the sysx, right? So it's just kind of, it's separation concerns, right? We have our main protocol messages, and then we have our sysx messages. So here, this is going to be, right, we're always going to hit this. This is going to be our start sysx. That next byte is always our command, our subcommand for that sysx message. And then our sysx data, right? And here, again, we're using our mixin, right, where we've declared all our different types. So we got our firmware query, capability response, analog mapping response, I2C. We actually use the range. Don't use the range stuff here. But this gets a little more complicated, right, because we're dealing with, like, arbitrary data. This could be stuff that doesn't quite fit in our 7-bit or 7-byte data, so we do some bit mashing here, bit fiddling to map. So this is actually mapping just this data to our ASCII characters, right? 32 through 126. So firmware names can only be ASCII characters. Obviously, you can see right there. So firmware query. This is going to give our firmware name. And we can dive into this a little bit. How am I doing on time? What do we got? 20 minutes? Oh. Okay, good. Okay. So this is where we're gonna map all that stuff. I don't know if we have that much time to go into all this stuff. But here you can see we've added sonar data, right? We're going to parse that. I'll show you that. So this is one of those custom types, right? Sometimes we get bad data, right? These sonars are really cheap, and sometimes just send junky data. So, but again, we're getting a value that is quite large, right? It's in microseconds. So it can be like 3,000 microseconds, right, if it's a long distance. That's not going to fit in there. So we get our least significant bit, most significant bit. They're in seven. They're 7 bits. So we're gonna move that over and then add our least significant bit. And that is going to give us a float, actually, a float value of how many microseconds that, or maybe it's an integer. I have to look. We'll see. But it gives us our value there, and we also get our trigger out of that, right? So the sysx messages are really easy, and the way Fermata generally does it is, so you have your sysx command, and then basically each byte after that is an argument that you're passing in or receiving back. And then, obviously, if you know you're going to be sending big data, if you know you're going to be sending, data that doesn't fit on your C side for this custom stuff, you're actually going to map it to least significant bit, most significant bit, something like that. which we do for our sonar data because we know it's going to be larger than what's going to fit in there. So let's dive into, let's see where I am here. We did that. Yeah, so the custom Fermata additions. I'm just going to pull up my notes really quick here because I've got a little command to run. Sorry. It's a little transparent. Is that still kind of legible? So this is just using the diff command. So now we're going to look at the C code, right? And just what I've added to, the C++ code on the Arduino, the standard Fermata, what I've added. So the stuff on the right here is what I've added to add the NeoPixel and the ultrasonic range sensors, right? So we've got that new ping library I mentioned, which is a non-blocking ping library for our C++ code, and then some of the Adafruit stuff to support the NeoPixel, which is great. Everything else on the left is standard Fermata, right? So our I2C definitions, like I said, that's all built into to standard Fermata. Here we can see I'm going to do my setup for ultrasonic. You'll see, you know, the pin mode. I believe that pin mode is built into Fermata. I forget what it is. Whether it's like I think there's a digital timer mode for a pin that you can set, and I think that's what that is. So we're saying, hey, this digital pin we're going to use as a timing one. So we just need to measure high and low on this thing, right? And we're going to use the new ping library to that. The sonar config, right? That 062 we can see maps to our Fermata code here, right? So we just have to make sure those are going to match up. Sonar data, same thing. Max sonars, that's for the C code. And then our NeoPixel stuff, right? So we're NeoPixel data registration, or setting the NeoPixel, right, is 072. Setting the brightness is 73. And registering what type of NeoPixel we have is 74, right? So again, mapping back and forth. Very easy. You just find a byte that isn't used and do that. And we're only going to support one NeoPixel for this one. You could have more, but then your registration and configuration code would be a little more complicated. This is very simple. And we're going to get some pointers to our some NeoPixels in the matrix. We're actually not using the matrix right now, but like I said. So now there's just lots of C code. I actually changed the sampling interval here. The new ping library had I was trying to like refine the distance sensing. So I was just kind of hard coding it here. You could do that from the Fermata code or from the Elixir side, right, to adjust your timing loops or your sampling interval. Like I said, the default is 19. I found 51 to work really well with the ping library and the ultrasonic sensors. And again, so there's, you know, it's custom hardware. There's going to be some tweaking going on here. So keep going down. Again, so we're just going to set up some of our ping variables for that new ping library. Trigger pins, how many counters we have. Lots and lots of C code, yay. Pin mode callbacks. I2C config. Okay. So I'm going to go back up here really quick. Most of the stuff, this is just one big switch statement, right? Yay, C++. Sysx callback, right? So this is what gets called anytime you send a sysx message into the microcontroller, right? Into that server. Sysx callback and the registration's down. You register this with the Fermata library saying, hey, anytime you get a sysx message, right, call this function. So we're just gonna see here, we're gonna switch on those bytes again. You know, not quite as elegant as our Elixir pattern matching, right, unfortunately. But this is doing a lot of the low level, right? This is doing all that low level stuff that we do not want to have to write, right? Fermata takes care of all this, right? I2C or I2C configuration, servos, digital analog pin mappings, right? Timing stuff. And it's well tested, supported by the community, totally open source, right? It's, I really like using it. If you really, really, really need to optimize, I recommend still starting with this and then pick apart the pieces that you need, right? The code is well written. I mean, it's one big file, right? But the code is really well written. And so when you're saying, you know, if you need to bring out your I2C stuff, just grab this, you know, optimize and customize whatever you need and throw that into your code. But this is really nice for prototyping, and I think it gets you pretty far for production as well. And it's a nice protocol. Okay, so we've got this one big switch statement. Now we're going to add our stuff, right? So we're sending these sysx messages. So we've got our sonar config. We're going to do our configuration here for our sonars. NeoPixel registration. NeoPixel addressing. And like I said, right, we pass in those messages with the sysx messages. Oh, we're off screen a little bit here. No, OK. With the sysx messages, it's always just assuming, like, as long as you're not doing like big floats or large integers, it's just assuming like each byte is arg0, arg1, arg2, arg3. So, right? And that's already given to us by Fermata. It's already done all that parsing for us. So you've got arg0 is our index, red, green, blue, right, to set our colors. And then we just called NeoPixel set pixel color. Super easy. Brightness, same thing. We're just setting one value in our sysx command. Again, unless we're sending a large value, then we need to, you know, do some of that bit fiddling to make it into 7 bits, past our least significant bit and most significant bit to pack it into our protocol. Totally ignore that. That is for a something else I'm doing. And here, because right, the sonar library. We need to, every one of those loops, those 51 milliseconds as we've configured it here, we need to, you know, check, right? This automatically will do our I2C stuff. It'll do our digital pins, our analog pins, our servo controls. We've added a new one where we need to go and check every iteration every loop if we've gotten results back from our pings and send pings if we need it. 5 minutes, perfect. And so we do that. And you can see where we, right, we get our result, and we're doing that bit fiddling there to send our least significant bit and most significant bit, because we've got a large integer that's not going to be fit into one byte. So we do that there, and then we write that data out back over the serial line to our Elixir client. So I kind of went over how we do, you know, how we map that to, right, that stuff in the C code to our Fermata client on the Elixir side. I don't think I need to go back into that right now. That thing I showed earlier, so this is actually what's, I'm going to do a little demo here, right, that general layout here. This is how I've got it laid out here. This is obviously our supervision tree from Observer. We've got our supervisor, our example board, which is actually going to call Fermata.board, and then we've got our UART process down at the very end. So that's actually where, you know, that interface is happening. I've got our distance or ultrasonic sensor, our NeoPixel, UART probe and wait for devices. Those are kind of customized for a project I'm working on. So I've got a bunch of devices. I'll try to be really quick. I've got a bunch of devices, USB devices that are plugged into a NeRVs device. They all use the same, all you get back when you enumerate over your UART interfaces is the FTDI. Right, the chipset, they're all the same FTDI. Totally different makers, they're all the exact same FTDI chip. So luckily, I control the firmware. I'm in control of the firmware. So I've added a little, that Fermata we saw in there, the string, you know, the serial.write is allowing for device registration. So I can open up all these UARTs after I enumerate them, get data back and say, okay, this is my Fermata client. This is my radio gateway. This is my whatever. So, and wait for devices is what does that. This is a hydroponic system I'm working on that's using Fermata, and obviously a little more advanced, not quite as trivial here. We're doing CO2, we've got PID controllers for CO2, temperature, humidity, nutrient dosing, pH dosing, we do lighting control, light readings. So we've got sensors for all of that, sensors for all the water quality, and then we've got cloud connections, you know, encrypted MQTT, all that kind of stuff. And that's all, so we've got a hardware, custom Arduino board, hardware control, that is essentially a dumb client, and then this is our observer in Elixir. Thank you. I'll give you a little demo here. So I got, 2 minutes? So I didn't go through any of this code, unfortunately. So it's waiting for device, right? This is where it's sending that Fermata. We've registered. We should be doing some pulsing. So all these messages, all this stuff coming, like controlling this NeoPixel, is actually coming from Elixir, right? So we've just got a process that's doing really tight loops, controlling this. We got a little follow example. And so now I'm adjusting the brightness of this based on distance from the ultrasonic sensor here. Woo! So you can imagine that being a wheel. And then here's a little tachometer. Right? So you can imagine that being a wheel, right? And so all of this, it's sending, you know, the ultrasonic sending the data into our Elixir process, our distance processor. That's broadcasting a message. Actually, the NeoPixel is just looping and calling into the other process to get its state. And then the NeoPixel process is just writing out to the NeoPixel library using that sysx command. So there. It works. Thank you. Oh, and yeah, here we can see the distance here. If you're not standing right there.
But it's interesting, you told me a bit about the Fermata protocol, and I looked it up very briefly at one point. I didn't realize, I was wondering why, you know, did they choose something that's a musical term?
Yeah.
Fermata with an E is you know, a musical notation. And so it's just interesting just suddenly to find out
it's super simple. It's super simple, yeah. And works well over, you know, USB, slow USB serial connection. So
some musician types just kind of realized it would work?
I don't know. The Fermata designer, I don't know why he chose MIDI. OSC, right, is the Open Sound Control. That's like a newer networkable protocol. I'm actually contemplating like moving to that. But yeah, I have no idea why they chose MIDI for Fermata.
Just again, interesting aspect of this. OK, we have time for questions.
That mapping is close, right? Yeah. Yeah. And it works well over like a slow, right, little serial connection. Yeah.
Continue on that. MIDI is also a specification in addition to a protocol, and specification includes octal isolation, which is super useful in these sort of remote control systems.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Okay. Yeah, so the C, right, so on the microcontroller, we're just running this really tight loop, right? I mean, imagine like an HTTP server, if you're familiar with, you know, like web stacks, right, which essentially just runs a really, really fast loop and waits for data to come in and then parses it, right? So that's what it's doing. On the C side, we're just running this really tight loop. On the Elixir side, we're either sending or receiving, it's an asynchronous communication protocol, right? So we either send a message into that C server, and it just looks for a byte and then does its thing, and maybe sends a response if it was required. So, I mean, you can really think of it like request response cycle, right? But very asynchronous. Does that make sense? No? Yeah, but it's dumb, right? I mean, it's abstracted. It's just like you've got a standard protocol like HTTP, right? Where say you say a GET request, is very similar to our, you know, a one byte message that we're sending over a serial, right, over a serial connection. So it's a similar idea. Yeah?
So would you say that your Elixir code is a client and the C code is a server?
Yes. I don't know what the benefit of that would be, right? You don't have, like, my laptop. So you could, right? Nerve's device, Raspberry Pi, has I2C. So you could write an Elixir server to, and then allow other devices to connect to your Raspberry Pi and use that as a microcontroller. You could definitely do that. I would actually probably recommend getting the, and I think you can do this, is run Arduino code on your Raspberry Pi. So I would just get that Arduino, the standard Fermata.ino file, to compile to the Raspberry Pi, and just run that on the Raspberry Pi. If that's what you really want to do. But it'd be a cool, you know, it'd be a fun thought experiment to write it. Give it a try.
All right. Is it not? Another round of applause, please.
Okay.